Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship this morning. Thank you for coming to worship with us today. Your presence is appreciated. I invite you to join us this morning in a time of confession and forgiveness. Please stand as you are able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who stretches out the heavens, who sends light to the nations, and who gives breath to us all.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Loving God, we confess that
we have turned from your way to follow our own ways. Forgive us for the times we have spoken or acted too quickly. We have not spoken or acted at all. We have hurt those closest to us. We have hurt those we have yet to know. We have thought more about ourselves than others. We have thought less of ourselves than we ought. Turn us around and give us a fresh start so that we can live again as your children. Amen.
Even when we have done wrong, God makes us right. Even when we have messed up, God puts us together. God's love never runs out. God never tires of calling us beloved children. Hear God say to you now, your sins are forgiven for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Take this, share the peace. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, mighty God. We worship you, we
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Everlasting God, you give strength to the weak and power to the faint. Make us agents of your healing and wholeness, that your good news may be made known to the ends of your creation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
First reading for today is from the book of Isaiah, the 40th chapter. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the very beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sets above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown. Scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth. When he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known, have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of the Lord. And the second reading is one of Paul's letters to the church in Corinth, the 9th chapter. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting. For an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this: that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews, I became as a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might be, by all means, save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to Mark, the first chapter. As soon as Jesus and the disciples left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted him for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." And he answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. The Gospel of the Lord. May be seated, and I invite the kids to come forward for a children's message. Hello. Morning. Quick question. Have any of you ever seen an eagle flying in the sky? Yeah? Cool. Yeah, they're pretty cool. Well, then you won't be surprised by what this is. So I've got a picture. Yeah, this is an eagle. It's soaring in the skies.
So we had that picture too.
You did? Yeah. Yeah, there's turkeys out there too. Well, yeah. So eagles don't need to flap their wings to fly. That's pretty cool. The wind actually lifts up their under their wings, so they glide on the wind. They don't flap their wings, they glide on it. Isn't that cool? The Bible story today talks about that. It talks about how eagles soar, how they are lifted up by the wind. And it says that whoever trusts in God is like a soaring eagle. It's like being lifted up by the wind. And so if we trust God, God lifts up us up when we're feeling low. So if you're feeling sad or you're feeling forgotten, you can trust that God cares and will give you strength to lift your mood and feel better. God is the wind beneath our wings. So let's pray. Repeat after me. Dear God, when we are sad or feeling low, help us to remember that we can always count on you to help us. Amen. Thanks for coming up. This morning I'm going to preach on Isaiah 40 and feel welcome to reference it in your bulletin. Most contemporary Bible scholars agree or have some agreement that there are multiple writers of the book of Isaiah, at least 2 to 3. I'm going to go with the philosophy that there were at least 3. Part 1, chapters 1 through 39, are attributed to the original Isaiah. They're preached between 740 and 687 BC. And they are preached during the rise of the Assyrian Empire. They're about the coming judgment and the face of an Assyrian invasion. Remember, a couple weeks ago I talked about the story of Jonah and how he was sent to speak to the Assyrians in Nineveh and about the northern kingdom. And so that's when this is being written, 1 through 39. Part 2 is chapters 40 through 60. It's attributed to the so-called Second Isaiah. Second Isaiah wrote 150 years later, 537 BC. This is when the Jews, those of the southern kingdom, Judah, were exiled in Babylon, and they're anticipating returning home someday. And so these chapters are about the judgment and condemnation of Judah, but they're also about the suffering servant who will come and allow the people to return from exile. And we read a lot about the suffering servant, chapters 41 and 42 and on, during Holy Week. You'll hear them on Good Friday, Monday, Thursday. Part 3, chapter 61 to 66. It's attributed to the so-called Third Isaiah. Third Isaiah wrote about 25 to 50 years later when the Jews returned from Babylon, addresses the need of the people to maintain hope. Our passage today, Isaiah 40, is from Second Isaiah. So this is the time they're in exile. Okay, so keep that in mind. That's your context. Chapter 40 asks this group of people a rhetorical question. The main point, actually a bunch of rhetorical questions. The main point of these questions seem to be, don't you remember what you already know about God? Don't you remember what you already know about God? The beginning part of Isaiah 40 is talking about the grandness of God, the greatness of God, by using the example of the grandness and greatness of the world, and that God is creation's source. So then it goes on to ask the rhetorical question, well, to whom do you equate God? And the answer is no one, nothing. There is no gods like God. And so finally we're asked, in light of this, how grand and great the creation is, and that God is the creator and no one compares to God, and God is great. Why are God's people saying that God doesn't see them, has disregarded them, has abandoned them? How can such a transcendent, powerful God fail to see what's happening to his people? And the answer is, he can't. God is great. The solution to the people's plight is not to get a stronger or more powerful God. It's not that God is inept. The solution is to wait in hope and faith for this God to act. That God does not get tired, but shares God's power with those who feel powerless, exhausted, and weak. God strengthens the powerless. This word's given to people who are worn out. They've been beat down. They feel forgotten. They're said to give the people strength to endure. That the people don't have to understand. That they should know that God is working. His understanding is beyond human reach, giving power to the tired, reviving the exhausted. But Israel has claimed that God has abandoned them, that God's defense is not, no, I didn't, but rather God responds with encouragement, with lifting up, acknowledges that we cannot pretend that the walk of faith is not exhausting. It is exhausting. That God understands this exhaustion, how exhaustion can lead people off the path, lose their way. The people want to know where God is in the midst of their suffering and exile, and the answer is here. I'm here. I never left you. It's like how I've spoken about the dark night of the soul last week. I spoke about that. The dark night of the soul being when the seeker cannot see the light, for the light is too bright to be seen. And so the seeker feels that they are in complete darkness, when truly they are enshrouded by this light that is so bright they don't see it. That God's light shines brighter than the seeker see, yet it is there. That God recognizes that people lose their way and promises strength for those who seek to find it again. Isaiah 40 is a long speech on behalf of God, and then it's followed by 41 and 42, which are a trial scene. And the image of the suffering servant who comes to lead the people like King David did, chosen by God, given God's spirit, bringing justice to everyone, Jews and foreigners alike. Now, having a servant, especially a suffering servant, as your hero, is as countercultural to the audience this is being preached to as it is to us today. We don't have suffering servants as our heroes. We see them as weak, powerless. How could that be the source and place of power? But it is. It's a different kind of power. It's the kind of power that a candle holds in a very dark room. It's the power of kindness and courage when life is in a state of chaos and despair. It's a lesson in the power found in vulnerability. When we experience brokenness as individuals or a group, when the world seems dark, when we become faint and weak-hearted and weary, God's grace and power works exactly in those times. We are broken, where we are fragile. We are the most open at those times to being renewed. In fact, we are nearer the mystery of God than ever. Isaiah 40 says he gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run, not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. There's two lessons from this text. There's two things we learn. The first one is get a bigger image of God's greatness. That God is bigger than our biggest trial. Enlarge your image of God. Of God's greatness and grandeur and power. Commentator Herbert Wolf put it this way: how easy it is to believe in the infinite power of God and at the same time to feel that he is unable to meet our personal needs. Get a bigger image of God's greatness. The second lesson that we receive in Isaiah 40, in this great little sermon, is that we need to wait. But it's an active waiting. It's a knowing waiting, an eager waiting, an anticipating waiting. It's looking forward to something. It's the kind of waiting, it's not the kind of waiting when you don't know what's going to happen. It's not an anxious, scared waiting. It's an anticipatory waiting because we know what's going to happen. The end of this waiting will be the greatness of God. But we need to keep, as Alan Ross puts it, an inner vigil. We're going to get a little practice with vigils this year. On the Saturday of Holy Week, we have worship. And the tradition in the church is that on Holy Saturday, you keep vigil. The Easter Vigil. The word vigil comes from Latin. It means awake or wakefulness. When we're vigilant, we are alert. We are on guard, we're aware, we're watchful. Vigil often refers to staying awake all night before a holy day. The Easter Vigil is on Saturday before Easter Sunday, and it is a worship service that is filled with prayer, with the storytelling of our faith story in creative ways. It's a time in the church when traditionally baptisms would take place, a welcoming of new members. So we reaffirm our baptism if there are not new members or baptisms to be done on that specific night. We reaffirm and acknowledge our baptism on that night. And we celebrate Christ's resurrection. As we begin the service in a hopeful anticipation, so there is a good chunk of time that is dedicated to the waiting. We don't celebrate the resurrection in Christ until the very, very end of the worship service. And that's how we leave the day. For ages, people would pray and meditate and read scripture, staying awake all night until God's actions of resurrection occurred. We're not going to stay up all night, but that is the whole model of that service. Waiting for God's work in our faith journey, it's empowered by God's strength. Because life is full of little vigils. There are the organized, worshipful types that we have in our tradition, but life's full of little vigils, those times when you know something great is about to happen, but we have to wait. Times when we are in this vigil, keeping vigil, they always end with times of God's presence, God's intervention, God's light shining in the darkness. That light we couldn't see, finally being made visible to us. One of my favorite songwriters is Leonard Cohen, and I have to share one of his verses because I think it fits so well in this lesson of the dark night of the soul, of the power of putting confidence in the greatness of God in our waiting vigil. He writes in the song Anthem, "Ring the bells that still can ring. Forget your perfect offering. There is a crack in everything. There is a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in. That's how the light gets in." Keep vigils for great things, for a great God is coming soon and very soon. Don't you remember what you already know about God? It is in our weariness and when our times of exhausted faith that the cracks of our imperfect offerings, that we are nearer the light, nearer the strengthening, nearer the foundness of our God who did not abandon us. So rejoice in your cracks, because that's how the light gets into your life. That's when you are nearest the mystery of God. And ring the bells that still can ring as we wait. Amen.
Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in
Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Confident that God, our light and our salvation, hears us when we pray, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. For the church, its pastors, deacons, musicians, artists, teachers, seminarians, and all proclaimers of the gospel, that your gift of steadfast love and mercy will spread throughout the world. Let us pray. For the earth and all living creatures, for those preparing fields for planting, and for favorable weather, that all of us who care for this life will find voice to help creation thrive. Let us pray. For all rulers of the earth in local, regional, national, and international offices, and those without the power of official office, that they will be given the courage to work for the protection of all people and act as servants of all. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For all who suffer this day, the sick and wounded, the grieving and brokenhearted, the hungry and exploited, those with malaria, and all who need our prayers, especially Jean Raines, Jack Myers, Francis Ryan, Henry Burke Bremenkamp, and Valerie Brown, that they will be consoled and healed by healthcare workers, counselors, family, and friends. Let us pray. For those who gather in fellowship and festivities, for the ministries of this congregation in our community and throughout the world, that in all our service we see ourselves centered around Christ. Let us pray. In thanksgiving for those who have died in the faith and now sing praises around the throne of God, and that we be assured of the promise of everlasting life, let us pray.
Merciful God, you hear our prayers even before we speak them. Receive them for the sake of the one through whom you have revealed your goodness, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated for a time of gifts.
Thank you.
merciful God, receive
the gifts we bring, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Through this meal, unite us as your body, shining with the light of your justice and mercy. For the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should in all places and in all times give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. By the leading of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan you proclaimed him your beloved son. And in the miracle of the water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to all to eat, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, blessed it, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "Take and drink. This cup is the new covenant of my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death and resurrection and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food. The body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. The meal is prepared and all are welcome to receive this meal of forgiveness. You'll be invited to come forward. You may stand or kneel along the railing. You'll receive the bread and then dark liquid, which is wine, or light liquid, which is grape juice, and gluten-free elements are available. Just let your server know. Come, let us eat.
Thank you.
invite you to stand and receive the blessing. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Morning star, fair and bright, you have refreshed us again with heavenly food. You are our dearest treasure. Go with us now, today, tomorrow, every day, that we tell the story of your never-ending love and sing your praise both now and forever.
You may be seated for announcements. Just turn your attention to the inserts you received. One being information about Messiah mission trip, and this is for adults and youth, so please check that out. And also in the messenger, next week, so we got a ton of stuff coming up. We got the Valentine's dance on Saturday, and next Sunday is the Area Ministry Palooza, and we are hosting it. This is Area 8 and 9. We'll be meeting here, so that's all the churches in Southwest Missouri and Eastern Kansas will be gathering here, representatives from those congregations, plus the Synod staff will be here. Highly encourage attending this, be an opportunity to meet the bishop and assistant to the bishops and just kind of hear a little on what's going on in our synod's business, but there's also a speaker and fun to be involved in this as well. So that's next weekend. Also, Council of Churches annual lunch is on February 15th, so if you would be interested in attending that, please let me or give Tracy a call. I think we have to give our numbers of attendance Wednesday. So if you'd be interested in attending that, I think about four or five people went last year. It's a good event to learn more about what Council of Churches is doing here in the Ozark area. Next Sunday, between worship services, we will have a special film presentation and speaker on the opioid epidemic, and I think this would be a very good and informative event to attend as well. Finally, Friday, February 16th, big thing in Nevada. I will never say Nevada the same again. Nevada, Missouri. And this is Bridges to Sustainable Communities Conference. Dr. DeVol will be presenting. He wrote a book called Bridges Out of Poverty, which is monumental book on sustainability and looking at poverty and maybe some new ways of approaching poverty. And this would be an excellent event to attend as well. The information for registering for this is available here. And let me know if anybody is interested in attending this. I'd love to know. And the rest you can read as far as announcements. So please stand, receive the benediction. The God of glory dwell in you richly, name you beloved, and shine brightly in your path. And the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Thank you.
Guided by the gospel, we welcome all to worship.
Make disciples, hunger for ministry, nurture youth, gather resources for our ministry, offer healing and care to all in need.
Go in peace, be the light of Christ. Thanks be to God. Alleluia.